So we are in 2 Thessalonians. We have been unpacking a couple different books here and are now into 2 Thessalonians. Good morning, Ray. And so we are going to look at a passage today, and then we will on Monday be looking through some views because we will end the verse today talking a little bit about eternal destruction. And what does that mean in the Greek and stuff behind it? And then so next Monday, we are going to talk about the great, wonderful, fun topic of hell and some of the different views. And so I'll look forward to Monday with you. Good morning, Pat. Good morning, Mom and Dad. Good morning, Robert. So 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, we're going to read verse 5 down to the end. This is evidence of the righteous judgment of God, that you may be considered worthy of the kingdom of God, for which you are also suffering, since indeed God considers it just to repay with affliction those who afflict you, and to grant relief to those who are afflicted as well as to you when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, inflicting vengeance on those who do not know God and on those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. They will suffer the punishment of eternal destruction away from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his might, when he comes on that day to be glorified in his saints and to be marveled at among all who have believed, because our testimony to you was believed. To this end, we always pray for you, that our God may make you worthy of his calling and may fulfill every resolve for good and every work of faith by his power, so that the name of our Lord Jesus may be glorified in you and you in him, according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. So, in a funny thing about this passage, in Greek, the whole verse 3 all the way to verse 10 is one run-on sentence. One sentence after, just all packed in together, which again is a little unusual for Paul's writings, but to be that long. But it was all one long run-on sentence. And the sentence points, like verse 3 ends in a sentence, verse 4 is a sentence. Those were kind of added in the translations because it just breaks up, makes a little more sense. And so therefore they added these sentences in there. It's a very unusual transition. We didn't read the first little part, but he's thanking, you know, and he's giving thanksgiving for their steadfastness. You know, verse 4 says that your steadfastness and faith in all your persecutions and in the afflictions that you are enduring. This is the evidence of the righteous judgment of God. How is thanksgiving the evidence of the righteous judgment of God? How is their faith in the midst of persecution the evidence of the righteous judgment of God? You know, it's a very unusual transition and moving from that praise and thanksgiving to the righteous judgment of God. And, you know, it seems to say that the perseverance and faith in the midst of their trials is the sign or the evidence to God's righteous judgment. The way they act in the midst of their trials and sufferings is the evidence of God's righteous judgment. Well, for one, the way you love in the midst of trials and the midst of those who don't love you is an evidence of God, right? An evidence of the marks of God. Good morning, Michaela. But they also, you could say the other side of it, is these Thessalonian believers, they were standing fast knowing that God is just and his judgment's right. They were standing fast. They were calm. They were secure because they knew in whom they have believed and forsaken that he is, they knew. They stand fast knowing God is just and his judgment is right. He will reward and judge those suffering will be counted as worthy. and the trials and the persecutions that we go through, which again, we've talked through it on here. We don't even begin to know the half of it. We don't. We have not experienced what believers in other countries experience. We don't know the trials and tribulations that of not even being able to meet together safely for fear of death, fear of a gun at our backs, kidnapping, murder, execution, so many things. They suffered through it knowing that God was just and he was righteous. His judgment would be fair and that he would reward and judge them worthy for their suffering. Now, this is a future hope. This wasn't a present hope. We sometimes in America, we turn it, we've gotten this all wrong and turned it into a health and prosperity gospel, and that God expects, so it's the full-on belief as a mature believer in one, that God loves you and has a great plan for your life. That's true. It exactly is, but we use that and twist that to mean that anytime you go through trials, sufferings, you stub your toe and God's against you because bad things come in threes. And we let Satan get us down, depressed, and messed up over a stubbed toe, over a bounced check, over an unexpected bill. Oh, first world problems, folks. First world problems. We turn that blessing, that expectation of God rewarding and judging those worthy, we turn that into a right now. And then we have suffering, and we don't, you know, God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life. Does not make sense when you have a diagnosis. It doesn't make sense when you're hurting and pain, when somebody in your family dies tragically. Just yesterday, I learned of two individuals, not that I really know well, but who lost family members in a moment. Kids under the age of 20 who in a moment died. Just in a moment. And in that moment, it's hard to believe that God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life. Well, where was that plan when they died, right? And so then we move to, well, God can use everything for his glory. You know, or God, no, secondly, I'm sorry, it's God will help you overcome. God will help you overcome. And so it's still about you. It's still about your strength and your overcoming and my being better for all of this instead of where we need to lead as believers and where the Thessalonian church was as they gave thanks, you know, rejoice always, pray continually and give thanks in all circumstances. Why? Because God is on the throne and God is in control. And we can believe that God can make everything work for his plan and his glory. We move through those stages in our walk with Christ, and God is and moved the Thessalonians there, and Paul was giving thanks for it and saying that their suffering was the testimony of this righteous judge that would reward future in the hope of heaven. You know, Paul intended to strengthen and comfort them and encourage those suffering with a glimpse of heaven. But Paul wasn't saying that suffering earns them a place in heaven. It doesn't say that suffering earns them a place in the kingdom. And there's no cry at the end of this in a kind of a works-oriented manner of, have I done enough? Has this been enough? The moment you go to walk into heaven and you're going, did I do enough? No, that's not at all what Paul was saying. In fact, there were those in the early churches that believed this. During the early church persecution in about 200 AD, there were groups who sought to be arrested. They sought to be thrown into the games and to die, to become martyrs, because they felt that the only way they could earn their way into heaven was to become a martyr for their faith. The problem was they weren't really becoming a martyr for their faith. Not all of them. Many of them, they were doing it out of an arrogance. They weren't doing it out of a hope in Christ. They were doing it out of a self-reliant arrogance, seeking greatness, right? What was the disciples' number one argument? Who will be the greatest in the kingdom? We do that so often. Really, the central theme of it all, again, was Jesus is coming again. So be faithful. Be faithful. Temporary trials, sufferings. You're going to have to go through them. But God's using it for His plan, for His glory. He's coming again. And it mentions a couple ways that He's coming again, right? From heaven. He's coming again from heaven, coming from God to execute the judgment. He's coming from God, heaven from God. He's coming in a blazing fire, right? Fire was often a symbol of judgment. It's a symbol of the Spirit, Holy Spirit falling, but it's also a lot of times in the Old Testament, it was more so used as this symbol of judgment. It was literally, what he said was kind of a fire, fire of flame is the fire from heaven, or a fire in motion, a moving. So if you've seen a forest fire, and we've read about them and how quickly they can just take over an entire, thousands of acres, that was this picture of God's judgment coming like that, like a blazing fire taking over. Says it'll be accompanied by angels, reinforcing the majesty, the glory, the power of God's glory, that angels are coming with Him. Not for us to worship angels, not to see angels as some crazy, amazing thing, right? And it says in that time that all this, when Christ is revealed, all those things will happen when Christ is revealed. It's that disclosure of that which was hidden. Christ is hidden for the moment in heaven. We can't see Him. But one day we will. One day we will, and all will be disclosed. Everything that was hidden from our sight, including the plan. Remember Sunday I said, I think and C.S. Lewis said something similar to this, but basically that the first word when I enter heaven, it'll probably be, oh, as in, oh, that's what you were doing there. We don't understand the trials. We don't understand the suffering, the pains, the momentary things that we go through, the bills upon bills that stack up that seem to overwhelm us, and yet God's there. God's there. God comes and will inflict full justice on the criminal. That's how Charles Finley put it. You know, He will inflict full justice on the criminal. Goes into verse 8 and 9 that those who rejected God's self-revelation in nature and history and have rejected the fuller revelation of Jesus Christ are the ones that will be destined for eternal judgment. Eternal destruction is how this passage puts it. It's the destiny of the disobedient. It's everlasting destruction. The key focus is that those not in Christ are very, throughout the time, I should say that whole passage, the focus is on those not in Christ. There's very little in this that talks about the believers. It's all talking about the eternal destruction and those that are found that have rejected the revelation of God in nature and in history, and then the fuller revelation that was given through Jesus Christ. God reveals Himself all around us in nature. And then Paul uses this word eternal destruction, and this is where I want to talk a little bit more about even next week, because this one phrase, this one verse has been used often to come into view an idea called annihilism. And annihilism, Annihilation. And annihilation is a view that basically anyone who's not in God's presence at the end times will all just be eternally destroyed. So therefore, the New Age was right. Because New Ageism is that we all just, when we die, we just die. Our essence floats out into all of space and eternity, and we have no consciousness, and we're just dead. And we're going to talk a lot more about that. And there's actually five main views of hell: literal, metaphorical, annihilation. There we go. I can't say it. A metaphorical view. Just and we're going to talk about them all. Five different views of hell. But verses like this can be very easily taken out of context. We read eternal destruction and we read what we think into it. These views typically come from someone reading the translation, right? We're reading the trans. You realize that. You're reading the translation. Unless you understand, we have a young man in our church who is extremely knowledgeable, and it's hilarious. He was a part of this men's Bible study just, and I just heard this from this past weekend, and he was talking about a book that he read, and it was fascinating, and it was an old book, and somebody said, "Man, I'd really like to read that," and he goes, "Well, would you like it in the original Latin or in English?" Because he had read it in the original Latin, because he can't, I mean, he's just a super intelligent young man. And the person didn't really think about that. So, scripture was Greek, it was Hebrew, it was Aramaic, and we read a translation of it and we're seeking to put into meaning. And when you go into the African tribes that have never seen snow, they don't say snow in Bible, in scripture they use different words. And we have one that says eternal destruction, and we can see destruction because destruction destroys, it eliminates. But here's the words: eternal in Greek is enios, something like that. Okay, so that's the Greek word, and basically, by around this time of this being written, somewhere in that 60s to 90 AD, that word actually meant lifelong, enduring. So some of these passages used to say things like eternal years instead of years of long past. They would use this word for that. Or eternal God, when what the original author was saying was God of old, right? And so they're talking about him being long, a lifelong, enduring, and everlasting and eternal. And then destruction. Olithros meant destruction of life. It meant also corruption. It meant physical death. And so those words are talking about a lifelong and enduring death, an enduring corruption. And so it's not necessarily destruction as sometimes we think of it. And so annihilationism comes from believing that destruction means it's gone, it's destroyed, it no longer exists. Can I tell you that that view is rising back up among the modern church today? And whether it's right or wrong, whether they can come up with scriptures, I'm not going to say it's a heresy. That's a far step. But what I will say is, and I've said it on here before, every belief has an outcome. If you believe that your family member who does not know Jesus is just going to one day die and not know that they're separated, not know that they have an eternity of a separation, of a corruption of what was intended, of an eternal death instead of eternal hope, eternal life, well, then there's no urgency in our need to evangelize. There's no urgency to share with them because, well, I'd rather them not feel poorly of me. And I mean, they're not going to know it anyways once they die. Do you understand? There's a outcome to every belief, and we're going to talk more about those. I don't want to jump away from that, but let me leave you with this one quote. So Charles Wanamaker, another theologian, put it this way about this term, eternal destruction. He goes, as there is no evidence in Paul or the rest of the New Testament, for that matter, for a concept of final annihilation of the godless, the expression eternal destruction should probably be taken as indicating the severity of the punishment awaiting the enemies of God, without seeking to specify its exact content beyond what Paul himself expresses in the phrase. You see, Paul was focusing on the exclusion from God's presence and the majesty of his power, not the lifelong, long-term floating off into nothingness. And so Monday, we're going to look at these views. Like I said, there's five main ones. There's the literal view. There's the metaphorical view. There's annihilation. There is this view. Purgatory is a view out there, and universalism. And we're going to look at all five of those on Monday and show scriptures, because all of them can point to a scripture or two. The question you always ask yourself, though, does it, like this quote from Charles Wanamaker, does it look at the whole of scripture? Does it just take one verse on itself? Does it look at the original word meanings or only an American translation? And so we're going to look at some of that on Monday. And so hopefully it will encourage us, because it's not meant to scare us. It's not meant to get us so overly focused on hell that we're, you know, no earthly good, or we're scared that we have to speak to everybody, because it's the Holy Spirit who convicts. But the idea is to know what we believe so that we're not pulled away, drawn away. Because like I said, there are a couple pastors that I know that I used to be a part of, like a church network with one of them, and he is very much so leaning into this idea of a conditional hell, that you go to hell for a little while until you pay your punishment and then you are annihilated. I have family members that have, I'm sure on both sides of the family, that have died without knowing Christ. And it sure would make it easier thinking that they're not in a place where there's weeping, there's gnashing of teeth, eternal separation from the very presence of God. But that sounds a little more human than it does looking at the sovereignty and fullness of who God is as the God who righteously judges them, who gives them any and every opportunity, revelation through the world around us. I mean, we could do a study, and maybe some of you have seen from Louis Giglio, the Incomprehensible, or one of his videos where he portrays how even in the blood, laminin, the cell laminin, look it up, kind of looks like a cross. You know, scientists got out, and the furthest they had gotten out anywhere, and they found a what they thought was the birthing of a new star, and it was shaped like a cross, right? A cross. Laminin looks like a cross. This, you know, and some are like, no, it looks more like an X, but it's a cross. Christ reveals himself. Talk to anybody who works with the heart, and they'll talk about just the wonders of the heart. Anybody who works with the brain, they'll talk about the wonders of the brain, whether they're believers or not. God has created us as humans to reveal his nature. Look at the world around us. We are in the midst of, depending on where you live, you know, the midst of fall, moving into winter. The seasons proclaim God's glory. everywhere around us when we look. The order, the wonder of God is there. He reveals himself to everyone. He seeks to draw all unto him. So we'll speak more about that on Monday with some of these different views. I hope you join us. So let's pray. God, we love you. We thank you. And Lord, I just thank you that you are a God who can we can trust, who takes sufferings, takes persecutions, takes momentary pain, temporary unrest and uneasiness, but you can use it for your plan and glory. Whether that be where we are as a nation right now, waiting on the election, or what's going on around us with COVID, or maybe diagnosis, maybe a job loss. Maybe you can use all of that for your glory, which is the salvation of all nations, to draw everyone closer to you. So God, may we not wait for the pain and suffering to draw closer. May we learn to trust you now in all things. It's not ignorance, it's not being naive, it's thoughtfully knowing and understanding your love, your chesed, your unimaginable grace. God, may we be overwhelmed with awe and wonder for who you are. Reveal yourself more and more to us today. And give us strength to go out. Because the world around us is rushing headlong towards eternal destruction. And that has greater, longer terms, hence eternal, ramifications. We should be worried, concerned, and be seeking to make a difference about. So God, we ask for your strength, for your discernment. Send us out, Lord, for your glory. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. 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 Well, go in peace, and hope you have a great weekend.